Thank you, dear God, for your love, dear God. We thank you for this morning, dear God. Dear God, we lift our hands to worship you, dear God. Dear God, through everything that we've been through this week, dear God, we know that you're the healer, dear God. And everything is possible. You are great. You are a great and mighty God. And how great is our God.
How great.
praise, church, this morning. Thank you, dear God. We thank you, Jesus.
Father, we just lift your name right here. God, I just thank you. I thank you, Lord, for all the many blessings that you've given each and every one of us. God, when we didn't deserve any of them. And God, I know right now that there's many of us, Lord, who are probably facing uncertain situations in our lives. Many of our loved ones who are going through situations that they don't have the answers to. And Father, I pray, Lord, for peace right now in those lives, in those hearts. God, just peace that would just cover us, that passes all understanding right now where we are, where they are, Father. Whether it's at home, God, or they're in the hospital room. Lord, just peace to cover them, Father. Lord, we just love you. We lift your holy name, Father.
In and out of situations that tug of war at me. All day long I struggle for the answers that I need. Then I come into his presence, and all my questions become clear. And it's for that sacred moment.
He is God Almighty. Jesus is your answer. Lift your hands to Him. The psalmist said, in His presence, there's fullness of joy. There's no reason to be lacking today. The presence of the Lord is here, touching you right now. Father, we bless you. Hallelujah. 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 We bless you for your presence. May we never take your presence for granted. When we sense you and we experience you, in whatever way you reveal and manifest, Lord, may we never take you for granted, your presence for granted. I want your presence, God. I want your presence in my life, in my marriage, in my family, in my church. I want your presence. And I bless you for them, for you. I praise you today. I praise you today. Thank you, Father. Church, there are many that are hurting. Some will be on this screen, some won't. Some are standing here this morning. Some may be watching online. But would you lift your hand or reach over and just touch the shoulder of the person nearest you, or reach your hand toward one another. I want us to touch God. I want to tell you that we need each other, don't we? We need the prayers of faith that the Lord has given to us. And on this screen, Marilyn's asking for our prayers this morning. She's a very sick woman in Fairview Hospital. Pray for her. Ken and Robin at home going through a rough week, but we're believing that God is bringing them even to a better state of health. Lisa Keating, she needs our prayers. So many up here. Sylvia, let's pray together. Father, we call on you. I pray for my brothers and sisters this morning. Lord, send your healing word into Fairview Hospital. Lift Marilyn Coleman up this morning. Lift her up with healing and recovery from COVID. We believe you, Lord. We trust you. Thank you for it right now. Thank you that you're touching her with your touch. Heavenly Father, we pray for Ken and Robin. Heal, my Father. Heal Lisa. Thank you for what you've already done. Minister healing, Lord, to Sylvia. Minister, Father, to these great needs as we see them. Minister to my brothers and sisters standing here this morning. Church, I just want to tell you, don't ever take for granted that the people you're standing by don't need a touch from God. Let's just one more time touch your shoulder or lift your hand toward one another. Father, in that name that's above every name, heal, minister, and touch. I want to tell you that as you just lift your hands now to the Lord, as you and I are in the presence of God like we've been in this time of worship and singing, there is no doubt in my mind that God is touching you, that God is healing, that He is strengthening, that He is encouraging. There's no doubt. You can't be in God's presence and not be changed. Lord, we thank you, we praise you, and we receive from you today. In Jesus' name. One more time, let's praise Him with a clap offering of praise. Amen. Amen. Oh, it's so good to see you today. In what I hope maybe is the last day of vacation for a while. I love vacations, don't you? But school starts back this week, and maybe we'll settle for a while. But in the meantime, you're here, and we're glad. Turn around and love on some people with the love of Jesus. Would you shake their hands? And before we give, I just want to say a couple of things, and I want to thank you for your giving to Advancing the Vision. And having said that, we have completed our sound system because you gave. And I got some good news. Not only were the designers able to give us the latest technology and what's called a linear sound, but we checked the decibels, and the decibel is the same on the front row as it is in the back, against the window, and along the aisle. Isn't that fantastic? Can you believe these little thin speakers can do that? That's technology today. But the good news even goes beyond that. You know, we had several busted speakers. You probably didn't know that, did you? One of those, that's true. One of those is busted, a couple that we had up here on the monitors. And so by your giving, we were able to upgrade the quality of our sounds. But the news, go ahead, praise him, praise the Lord. But the good news even gets better, because what was supposed to have cost us about $28,000, it kept getting lower and lower because we were able to do this. And some things worked out even after our installer got here and our designer got here. This came in under $20,000, right at $20,000. Can you praise God for that? The council didn't even know that. I think I told one this morning. But is God good? Yes, he is. And thank you for your faithful giving. And that's those blue cards that you see there. That's what that's all about. We're just, because of your generosity here, we're just going to get some things done to upgrade and improve. And next is the sign, and we've already got more than $10,000 because this didn't cost us so much. But we're going to need about $40,000 on the new digital sign up front to really give us the curb appeal and the information we need to get out to our community. So thank you so very much for giving. That'll be next, and as soon as those funds are in, we'll move on with the sign. But you're so faithful. And so as you see, the giving app, wherever you are, whatever you have to give, we appreciate it. You can give it online. You can give it in the offering plate as you leave. Now, tonight is the back-to-school bash. We have 200 bags of school supplies that were given out in our community and in our church. And because COVID has kind of raised its ugly head in our community again, kind of with a renewed type of concern, we're going to do a drive-through event, and our servers will be, people will just drive through and get their bag of school supplies and a snack, and we're not going to do the inflatables, and we're not going to be able to do the dental kits because of COVID that has prevented that, but we are going to give the free physicals, and our brave nurses here, we've got a plan and procedures in place to make that very, very safe. Do y'all appreciate your church? Just give yourselves a hand. You just go over and beyond. I just really appreciate it. So so having said that, thank you so very, very much. That too is because of your generosity and tithing and giving that we're able to do this great outreach. Next week, I'm going to begin with you a 21-day emphasis of prayer. We're going to be back from vacation this summer, hopefully. And we're going to just focus on what God wants to do, not just for our church, but us personally too. And for 21 days, I'm going to have a prayer emphasis with you. It'll be doable. And I can't wait to share that next week. So I'll have all that ready to go next week and in the month of August as school has returned and people are kind of getting settled back in. We're going to focus on the Lord and what he wants and what he wants to do. Anybody with me on that? And I appreciate those three that are. Thank you so much. But we're two or three gathered together in his name. There the Lord said, I am. So I'm not worried about it. No, I know you're with me. So thank you so very much for that. Let's turn our attention to the screen and get this week's announcements.
Good morning. We are so glad you decided to join us for worship here at Battle Your Church of God.
If you're a first-time guest here, we want to connect with you. You can fill out the Connect card in the pew in front of you, or you can scan the QR code on the back of the bulletin you've just received.
Or you can visit our webpage at vadeochurch.org and click Connect on the top right corner. Be sure to stop by the Welcome Center to get your free gift.
We look forward to seeing you at our next service.
Activities begin today at 5 p.m. for our back-to-school giveaway. Free school supplies, snacks, sports physicals, and a chance to win two $100 gift cards. Volunteers are asked to be here at 4 p.m. for final preparation. Our statewide senior adult celebration is Saturday, August the 14th. Today is the deadline to register. See Pastor Merritt following the morning worship service if you plan to attend. Tribe wards are all over, and now it's time to party. Wednesday night, we will have a night of fun with water slides, snow cones, and other fun things. So students plan to be here Wednesday night at 6:30.
It's almost time. Girlfriends is having a dinner party on Friday, August the 13th, and we want you to be there. To attend, all you need to do is RSVP on our church website. Enter your email, and just like that, we know you're attending. You do not want to miss this night. Sister Till Jeffers is going to be our guest speaker. Come dine with us.
We are having a tea party for our girls, ages 3 to 5th grade. Wear your favorite sundress and don't forget your hat. You can RSVP online. See you soon. Brother Jason and Brother Elmer will be taking our boys club to earn their BB badge. It's going to be a fun day of target shooting. Parents, be sure to mark your calendars.
It's a Friday night fellowship for our young adults. Friday night, August the 20th. I will have more information next week, so just make plans to be there. You don't want to miss it.
You can stay up to date with all of our church events by following our social media platforms.
Now you know some of the happenings here at the Vidalia Church. We invite you to become a part of what God is doing here. Should you need Pastor Merritt or the staff, just give us a call. Our phone numbers are listed in your bulletin. Have a great week, and we'll see you at the next service.
This morning, I'm going to minister for the next few minutes on when grace is all you need. I don't know what your needs are here. I don't know what difficulties all of you are going through. You may be in need in relationship restorations. You may be in need of healing for your health. You may be in need for a financial miracle in your life. I don't know. But what I do know is grace is all you need. There's a passage of Scripture that we're so familiar with. I think the reason we're so familiar with it is we've had to speak it over our lives so many times. Many of you could quote it from memory, I'm very sure. It's when the Apostle Paul was going through such a difficult time in his life that Jesus himself spoke to him these words in 2 Corinthians 12 and 9. This is from the Message paraphrase. Let it get into your heart, spirit, mind this morning. Lord, how can this change me? Jesus said, my grace is enough. Say it with me. It's all you need. My strength comes into its own in your weakness. Whatever Paul was going through, Jesus spoke directly to him, and because this is inspired word today, he's speaking that to you. You can receive these words and apply these words to your own heart and to your own life. Grace is all you need. You know, grace is an attitude of God. It's an attitude of God toward us all. It's an attitude of his kindness, his mercy, his benevolence. It's an attitude of God's favor, his unmerited favor, his free gift to every one of us in this world today. But not only is grace the attitude God has toward us, grace is the action He took toward us. He doesn't just have an attitude of benevolence, mercy, and kindness, and unmerited favor, but He's got an empowerment for you this morning. You notice on the screen the words grace and strength, they're synonyms. That's very true. Grace is such a magnificent, no wonder the songwriter wrote Amazing Grace. It's amazing. Because it's such a multifaceted word and work of God in our lives. And grace and strength are synonyms. And when Jesus said to Paul and says to us this morning, "My grace is enough," it comes from a Greek word that means protective power. It is a refuge for you. That was interesting that that word enough meant that. That word enough, E-N-O-U-G-H. It means that He makes you competent. Anybody ever felt incompetent in here? On your job, in your ministry, in your marriage? And He was saying, "Paul, I'm making you competent by My grace. I'm giving you enough." It's a protective grace that's going to guard your life. And so not only has God got an attitude of benevolence for us, but He's got an empowerment. He's got an action that He's taken in your life so that grace is all you need. C.S. Lewis was once asked, "What is the difference between Christianity and the religions of the world?" Lewis said, in a word, it's grace. You see, religion can give you a belief system. Religion can give you creeds to recite. Religion can give you laws to keep. It can give you prayers to pray and songs to sing. But religion can't give you grace. There's only one place that grace comes from, and that's from the Lord Jesus Christ. He Himself is the very epitome of grace for every one of us. He is the attitude that brought Him from where He was to this world so that you and I could know empowerment in our lives for whatever we're going through. Relationship issues, health issues, ministry issues, whatever they may be. As a matter of fact, John wrote it this way in John 1:17. He said, "The law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." You know, grace didn't come through Noah and the ark. Grace didn't come through the Abrahamic covenant, even though that would be fulfilled in Jesus. Grace didn't come through Moses and the law. Grace didn't come through Buddha and the Enlightenment. Grace didn't come through Muhammad and the Quran. Grace didn't come through philosophies like Socrates and Plato and Aristotle. Grace didn't come through sacraments, as much as we appreciate what God does for us in the communion, in the water baptism. Grace doesn't come through church membership. But grace came by Jesus Christ when He entered this world in Bethlehem and took on Himself our flesh that He might be our Savior and we could sing joy to the world. The Lord has come. Grace came on Mount Calvary when He was wounded for our transgressions and He was bruised for our iniquities so that He may pay the awful penalty of every one of our sin debt. Grace came at that empty tomb when He rose up victoriously over death and hell. Hallelujah. And He gives us justification by faith and life everlasting. Grace came when he ascended to the right hand of the Father. And I tell you, grace is here right now because at the right hand of the Father, he ever lives to make intercession for us, whatever your need may be today. Grace is coming back again, crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And every knee is going to bow and tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Grace came through Jesus Christ. So I don't know what you're going through today, but I want to tell you that God's grace will see you through. And what more do you need? And I hope somehow in this message you will say that. What more do I need besides what God has given to me in his grace? I just want to look just for it. I'm going to close out with some principles. Bam, 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 bam. There's about five of them. But I want us to look at Paul, because we're going to learn some lessons in those principles I'm going to give you at the end to help us. And as a matter of fact, we don't know what Paul was going through, but we do know that he was going through a very difficult time. Now, let me set this in context. The context of this is that he is having some relationship issues with his church members at Corinth. And you don't read far into 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians before you know that. And the Apostle Paul is dealing with what he calls false apostles. He calls them super apostles. And he said they're able to masquerade as the apostles of Christ. And no wonder that Satan himself masquerades and transforms himself into an angel of light. And he's dealing with some people that have crept into the Corinthian church, and they have turned Paul, they have turned the Corinthians against their leader, their apostle. And if you read this in chapter 11 and the rest of chapter 12, you'll find out that they were saying Paul's not really an apostle. And he wasn't there with Jesus, and he wasn't this, and he wasn't that, and he's too weak to be an apostle. Matter of fact, he can't speak worth a lick. And so they're feeding the Corinthians this. They're causing disruption, not only in this church, but in other churches, to get the people of Corinth not to follow their leader, not to listen to their leader. But here's the deal. Paul found himself tempted to boast about that, about his credentials as an apostle. He really felt tempted to tell them how great he was, how much he had done, how much he had accomplished in life. But then he remembered something that happened to him 14 years earlier. He remembered a time when he was encountering God and God was preparing him for ministry in a greater measure, that he was absolutely transported from this earth to heaven. And he saw things in heaven that he said are inexpressible with men's words. He says, as a matter of fact, it is not even legal for me to talk to you about what I saw in heaven. But these experiences that he had had 14 years earlier, these visions, these revelations that he had from God when he got that revelation of heaven and saw it and was there, whether in the body or out of the body, he said, I really don't know. He was battling pride. Now, you got to read between the lines. Paul and Peter and the other apostles in the Bible, they're no different than me and you. They deal with temptations and struggles. Obviously, they were great men and women of God. But he was dealing with pride. And that same temptation that he had when he had those great revelations 14 years ago, just to get out there and write a book and make $1 billion on it by what he saw, that pride to boast about what he had done and seen, who he was, had crept back in when he's trying to defend himself as an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul knew He needed grace so that he wouldn't boast, so that he wouldn't get prideful. I want to tell you, pride goes before destruction. He knew how destructive it would be in his life, in the church, and on others. And a Holy Spirit goes before a fall. And Paul didn't want to fall. He wasn't in this thing to fall. And so he recalls that. And here's what he says about that time that God gave to him when he was going through 14 years earlier. Look at it in verse 7. He says, so to keep me from becoming proud. All of those heavenly revelations. I was given a thorn in my flesh. Now, we do not know what the thorn was. And it's one of the great questions of the Bible. And scholars debate it. And they all talk about it. Some scholars will say, well, it was some debilitating disease that Paul had. One guy said that he had a troubled marriage. That was his thorn in the flesh. Ladies, I love you. I didn't say it. Well, that might answer why he stayed on the road in ministry all the time. I don't know. But others believe that it was a person, that this thorn in the flesh was somebody irritating him and trying him beyond anything that he knew how to deal with. Now, I want to tell you, a thorn's painful. It hurts. It's going to cause you some discomfort, but it's not life-threatening. Amen? You can go on, move on, but it's always there, just always feeling it. And he's dealing with this thorn. And beyond that, Paul continues to say to them that it was a messenger from Satan to torment me. I mean, this is heavy-duty stuff. And what Paul was seeing in this person, supposedly, that's going to be the theory I used, doesn't matter. What Paul was seeing was a person that was irritating and tormenting and trying to do everything he could to undermine Paul or hurt his ministry or hurt his influence somewhere. And the Apostle Paul is just dealing with this. And he says it was a messenger of Satan. Now, here's where the gift of discerning of spirits, little s, comes in your life. It's one of the nine in 1 Corinthians 12. Paul was able to see beyond that person that was doing that. He said he was a messenger of Satan. He was able to see beyond flesh and blood because we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against principalities and powers and rulers of this dark world, spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. That's what the discerning of spirits. It lets you know the spirit behind an awful circumstance you may be going through. And I want to tell you that every time somebody irritates us or causes us discomfort or some grief, it is not a messenger of Satan. I just want to throw that out there. Half of us be divorced. No. It's kind of like the Apostle Peter when he got the great revelation when Jesus said, Who do you say that I am? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus said, Peter, flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. Don't get all high and mighty. Don't get in super spiritual pride. Flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you, but my Father who is in heaven revealed that to you. And you remember, he said, you know, I'm going to give you the keys of the kingdom. I'm going to build my church on the fact that I'm the rock, the Messiah. And this is what Peter did. The very next verse, Jesus starts telling them how he's going to the cross. This is the first time he does this. He's going to be delivered into the hands of sinful men. He's going to be mistreated. He is going to be mocked. He is going to be tried. He is going to be killed and put to death on the cross. But the third day he'll rise again. And Peter comes up to Jesus and throws his arm around him. He said, Jesus, let's take a walk. Now, Jesus, you remember I just got the revelation. Let me tell you what is not going to happen. I got the revelation. That's not going to happen to you. You're not going to be arrested. You're not going to be put to death. You're not going to be mistreated. That is not going to happen to you. And Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not appreciate the things of God, but those that are of men." And here's the point. Did Jesus cast Peter over to the sides? "I ain't using you again." No, we have to understand sometimes the spirit behind the person that's being used. But you got to discern whether or not, and for Paul, it was a spiritual attack. That's what I'm saying. That's how bad this was. It wasn't just your ordinary. And he says, and to keep me from becoming proud. That's what this guy, this woman, whoever it was tormenting him to keep him from becoming proud about all those heavenly revelations that he had and seen. Three different times I begged the Lord. You ever got to that point? I begged the Lord to take it away. And beginning in verse 9, he said, each time he said to me, "My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So now, I am glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults and hardships and persecutions coming from that messenger of Satan, perhaps, and troubles. It doesn't matter what it is, circumstances or relationships or adversity, and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, hallelujah, then I am strong." Why? Oh, because grace is all you need. Grace was enough. He was all Paul needed. I want to tell you, it got Paul back on track. He wasn't about to fall in that trap again. And I want to tell you, whatever you are going through, grace is all you need to get you through. And what do we learn from Paul? Here they are. Number one, we need to learn to humble ourselves. Humble yourself. You know, Lord, it's hard to be humble when you're perfect in every way, I know. I'm going to write a book on humility, and it's going to have 5,000 pictures of me. Paul said again, 2 Corinthians 12 and 7, "So to keep me from becoming proud, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me and keep me from becoming proud." He says it twice. I want to ask you, how would you like to have a prayer partner, an accountability partner, a mentor that you met with for coffee, and you're having coffee, and you pull out your Bible and say, "I want to show you what I found this morning in Psalm 23. I want to show you this nugget. I want to show you this revelation." And you show them, and your mentor, your friend says, "That's nice. Let me tell you what I saw last night when I went to heaven." And you might have a little inkling of what it could have been to have a proud Paul as your mentor, as your prayer partner. And you say, "I'll see you at lunch. I'm not even talking to you." But that tendency to be proud, pride is going to prevent us from experiencing all that we need in God's grace. The Bible says so. And humility is our answer. Humility, this is my definition. Humility is not thinking of yourself any more or any less than God knows you are. Humility is admitting I can't, but the God who loves me and the Christ who's in me and the power of the Holy Spirit who has empowered me, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. In other words, it's just coming to an end of ourselves and realizing that, and that our abilities and our talent and even our spiritual experiences, they are not enough. I got to have Him. I need Him. We used to sing, "Every hour I need you, O Lord. Touch me now, Father." And humility is really just being
so dependent on the Lord that you realize that without God, you'll fall flat on your face. This is what James writes about it in James 4 and 6. He says, but he gives us more grace. How many of you want more grace? I need some more grace. Amen. But he gives us more grace. That is why the scripture says, God opposes the proud. Here it is. He gives grace to who? Who gives grace to who? To the humble. Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6, humble yourselves then before the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due season, casting all of your care on him because he cares for you. Amen. So here's the first step. Just acknowledge that Jesus and his grace is all you need, and without his strength, you can't make it. Here's number two. Pray first. You know, I think of 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. And those two go together. And that's what Paul did. And that's what we have to do. And when I say pray first, I'm talking about make prayer a first response and not a last resort in our lives. You know, Paul, he's seeking the Lord. Have we forgot the art of seeking God? And I'm not saying that we've got to come to the altar after every service and stay an hour on our knees. That wouldn't be a bad idea, though, would it? How many of us have forgot the times that we were so in need, our child was so in need, our marriage was so in need that we pleaded with God and we prayed and we were holding on to the horns of the altar, we say, until God answered us. And I want to tell you, grace is all you need. Because when you start seeking the Lord like that, I'm telling you, God's showing up and God is answering you. And he says in verse 8, three different times, I beg the Lord to take it away. Three times tells us that he was persistent in prayer. He was, oh God, over and over again, move this thorn, move this person out of my life that's irritating me, that's trying to hinder me and hurt me and stop me. He sought the Lord in prayer until God answered. Do we pray till God answers? Or do we just pray our little lay me down to sleep prayer and go to the banker, go to the doctor? Those are all good things. But I want to pray till the answer comes. And the answer might not be what I want it to be, but the answer is always the right answer. And it's just the grace that I need. Jesus said in Matthew 7:7, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. And he means keep on asking. That's the Greek there. Everyone who seeks and keeps on seeking finds. To everyone who knocks, it shall be opened to them. For what man of you, father of you, would have a son who asked him for a piece of bread would give him a stone? And if he asked for you, ask of you to give him an egg, you'd give him a scorpion, or a fish, you would give him a snake. He said, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more, oh, he's the God of all grace, how much more shall your heavenly Father give you grace, give you the things that you have asked for, that you need in your life, amen? And prayer is a, you know, prayer is a mystery, isn't it? It's a great gift. But prayer is such a mystery. I don't understand the mystery of prayer, but I tell you what I do know. I understand it works. You see, prayer is more of a law that works than is the law of physics. I got this, you know, this smartphone here. You got an updated one. And in, you know, now they've told me how this works. And I know there's radio transmissions and all. I don't understand the physics of it. My wife's dad was totally blown away the first time she picked him up in one of our automobiles. And Kim said to Siri, gave the address, and she starts talking. And her, how does she know? You know, we don't know how it works, but we know it works. And you know, in this little cell phone, isn't this remarkable? Kind of like these little speakers here, but in this little cell phone is my computer, it's my library, it's my song list, my stereo, it's my calendar, it's my GPS, and it's not my Keurig coffee maker, but that's the next update that's coming out. I'm convinced of it. I don't understand how, well, I kind of know it generally, but I know it works. I'm going to use it. Prayer is more sure than the law of physics because I want to tell you, prayer works. And the same God that got Paul through 14 years ago, he knew would get him through this trial at Corinth. And that's what I want to say. He's talking about 14 years ago. Isn't it amazing how that we come up against a new struggle and problem? And God, I don't know if I'm going to get through this. All we got to do is look back. I want to tell you, I'm thinking specifically right now. There's been times in my life I thought I was down for the count. I thought I was going under for the last time. But it was God's grace. When I cried out to him, when I pleaded with him, when I said, oh God, I got to have you, God. I got to have your touch in my life. I want to tell you, God came through and he lifted me up out of that miry clay. He set my feet upon a rock and he established my going and my destinations. And he put a new song in my mouth, even praise to our God. I'm not just getting through it. I'm telling you, I'm going through it singing the song of the Lord. Amen. And that's what Paul does. Just look back all the times. Let me ask you something. How many of you would raise your hand this morning and say, I remember a time that I thought I was a goner, maybe in death or in sickness or a relationship? How many of you raise your hand and say, God came through? You just testify. You know, we sang a song years ago, He'll Do It Again. And he really will do it again. And I think there's a new version of that title, with that title. But pray off, build off the last time. That's what Paul is saying to us. So grace is all you need, whether God removes it or takes you through it. Just pray and wait for God's grace to answer. Number three, find purpose. Now that's hard. We don't know what the thorn is. Paul didn't know what the thorn was. And here's what we do. We spend our time analyzing. Why? Why am I going through this? What did I do wrong to deserve this? And we spend all of our time on what the thorn is, just like those theologians. We don't know what the thorn was. Paul knew, but he didn't focus on what it was and why it was there. He focused on what it could do and how he could learn from it and grow from it. And that's what you and I got to do. He found purpose. And the first purpose he found in that thorn, he said that it kept me from getting into destructive pride, to just dash my life against a proud rock in this world and keep me from going on. It kept my feet on the ground. And also, he found purpose because he said, it helped me to understand. It helped me understand my weakness isn't God's limitation. I got limitations. Anybody else? But your limitation doesn't hinder God. All he wants us to do is when we're going through that trial is find grace. That'll help us learn from that problem, grow from that problem, become mature. As a matter of fact, Peter said it this way, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And once, once you get to that place in your life, you're going through a struggle and you humble yourself and you pray first and then you find purpose. Here's number four, receive the grace. Grace is free, but grace is a gift and I need to receive it by faith. And, grace is grace. It's free. But I got to act on it. I got to step out on it. And the Apostle Paul says in verse 8 again, he said, each time, he said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. Receive your, well, I don't know what you're going through, but I just want to say, receive your grace gift for that particular need. Did you know that God has different kinds of grace? He's got all kinds of graces. As I was going through this, and I'm not even going to give you all of it that I know, but I was thinking about Forrest Gump's conversation with his best good buddy, best good friend, Bubba, and he told him all the ways he could do shrimp. Well, I want to tell you, grace is better. You know, there's a universal grace. God has graced every person in this world, whether they acknowledge God or they don't acknowledge Him. In Matthew 5 and 45, He said He causes His sun to rise on the evil and on the good. He causes it to rain on the just and the unjust. We are in this place today lifting our hands and acknowledging the God of all grace. Amen. That's the difference between us and the people out there. God loves them as much as He loves us. Amen. There's a saving grace. You know about that. How would you like to be in a court of law and somebody stood up on your behalf? You're facing condemnation or even sentencing a penalty of death. And they said, I'll take your place. And that's what the Lord Jesus Christ did for us in Romans 3 and 23. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But listen, God has justified us freely by His grace in the Lord Jesus Christ. For by grace are you saved, through faith. And that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. There's a serving grace. There's a liberating grace, Romans 6 and 14. A serving grace, Romans 12 and 6. There's a witnessing grace, the apostles, that said that when they were threatened by the Sanhedrin, that great grace was upon them, and they gave witness to the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a working grace, 1 Corinthians 15 and 10. Paul said, for by the grace of God, I am what I am, and His grace on me was not least of all the least. He said, but because of His grace, I worked harder than all of them. There's a helping grace. And let us come boldly before the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find help, find grace to help us in our time of need. There's a teaching grace. Now, you won't see this one coming. Titus chapter 2 and verse 11, when he says, but the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we should live righteously and godly and sober in this present world. I want to tell you, God's got a, do you need a liberating grace? Do you need a healing grace? Do you need a saving grace? God's got a grace exactly for the need that you have this morning. That's the whole point. Meet you right where you are. Praise the Lord. And then finally, I just put the word rest. Grace is all you need. Grace is all you need. That word rest in the scripture I'm about to give, I'm not going to give it to you yet, is an interesting word. When he's, and don't put up the scripture just quite yet, but when Paul says, he said, I'm going to boast in my weaknesses that the power of Christ may rest on me. It means to cover like a tent. Cover like a tent. Grace covers us. I remember mine and Kim's first vacation. We were 21 and 20, something like that. She was actually 14 now. We were very young, and we were going to go on our first vacation, and we didn't have any money, and I borrowed a Boy Scout tent. And was I cheap or what? And we took off to the mountains, and we got in the mountains and went to Elkmont and the Great Smokies and pitched our tent. And I didn't know a thing about canvas, but we got there late, and I'm trying to stake down that tent, and it's getting dark, and Kim just thinks I'm wonderful that I can drive those stakes in that hard rock. And all of a sudden it started raining, and I didn't know you weren't supposed to rub the inside of canvas or it was going to leak everywhere, and I'm telling you, everything got wet. And maybe our tent wasn't treated or something, I don't know. And we endured that for about 3 days. And she looked at me, I've had enough of camp. So we went to Gatlinburg, got a room, and went in debt. I love you, honey. A big spender. But we were, let me tell you about God's, he's got in mind the tabernacle. When the Shekinah glory came in, and they couldn't even minister for the glory and the grace and the power of God's love and magnificence and help. I want to tell you, God's grace will cover you and it'll protect you. And as you look at this verse of scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, he says, therefore I will boast. He's not going to boast about who he is and what he had done. He says, but therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses and insults. Oh, watch it, church. In hardships and persecutions, in difficulties. Oh, praise God for this statement. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Anybody need strength in this place this morning? I want to tell you, there's a strength for you. There's a grace that'll give you an anointing. It'll give you a blessing. It'll give you a calling. It'll give you a deliverance. I want to tell you, there is a blessing that'll make you strong this morning. And we don't know what happened to that thorn. Doesn't matter. Paul gave it to God. He left it there and he rested. That's the height of maturity in Christianity. That's the height of your spiritual experience, that you can rest in the finished work of the cross of Jesus Christ and the empty tomb. That you and I can rest. It's all going to be okay. God's got this. Hallelujah. God's got a grace for every need and difficulty you have this morning. And all we have to do is rest. Humble yourselves. Pray and seek the Lord. Give it to Him first. Find purpose. Yeah, all of those are important. Receive that grace by faith, but then rest. Rest. And I think that's the word that many of us might need here this morning. You've given it to God. And here's the joyful thing. Paul didn't trade his thorn and his weakness for God's strength. Paul's weakness and that thorn that he suffered was transformed into God's strength. And the thing that makes you cry this morning is the thing that's going to make you laugh and rejoice and joy. And though he said, I don't understand it. I don't either. And Jesus said it this way in John 16, 20 through 22. He said, the thing that makes you weep now is going to make you rejoice. He said, it's just like a mother when she goes through those childbirthing pains, and oh, it's painful, isn't it, ladies, mothers? Don't you know it is? But I want to tell you, just the moment that you hold that little baby in your arms, all of that pain is forgotten, all of that sorrow, all of that suffering, it's forgotten. You know why? Because you've got a new life baby that you love more than life itself. That's the way God looks at you. He's got a grace for you, and everything that made you weep is going to make you cry if you'll depend on His grace and say, Lord, it's enough. Your grace is enough for me. I want to ask you to stand with me, please. Father, I love you today. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Father, I thank you for the way that you've ministered today through the songs and the worship and the word. I just thank you, Father, for who you are. And I'm keenly aware that there's some people. I don't want to be flippant, Father, because you're not. That thorn in Paul's flesh, it touched you. It stuck you because it stuck him. And that's the same with your people here this morning. You feel our pain. And I pray for those right now that are going through. In Jesus' name, I pray for them. They're going through it right now. And it doesn't matter what the thorn is. It doesn't matter what they're going through. But I pray when they leave this place today, they're going to know that grace is all they need. Grace, your grace. Hallelujah, is all they need. Grace is all they need. Help them to receive it this morning by faith. Rest in it. I thank you for it and praise you for it. I'm going to ask you to stand. And I'm going to do a general altar call. I'm going to have a testimony in just a minute. I'm going to do a general altar call this morning. Would you just meet me in the altar here? Just come from wherever where you are. We're going to have a very short testimony or testimonies. It's just designed to encourage you this morning. And then we're going to sing a benediction of grace. And then we're going to go in that grace. We're going to rest in it. Come around. While you're coming, I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what your needs are. But I want you to come saying, grace is all I need. It's a person in your life that you love more than life itself. But they're tormenting you. Maybe you love them so much. But grace is all you need. Maybe it's a pain. Maybe it's a sickness. Maybe it's a... I don't know. If you're standing where you are, you receive this too. I'm going to stretch my hands towards you. I want you to lay your hands on people around you. I want to tell you, people in this building, some of them have gone through. They've gone through the grind of it all. They've gone through the furnace. Father, in that name that's above every name, in the name of Jesus, I'm praying for rest. Even now, rest. Hallelujah. That the power of Christ is going to start resting on people that's calling out to you and believing you and trusting you. And I thank you for it. Lord, we're receiving it right now. We're receiving it. Let God touch you right where you are. Would you let him touch you? Would you just, you know, sometimes you just need to feel God. You can feel him this morning. I know it's not by feeling, it's by faith. But you can feel him. If you just lift up, let him touch you. Let him lift you up today. Let him strengthen you this morning in this place. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, thank you for mercy and grace. Thank you for mercy and grace. I bless you, Lord. I bless you. Yes, Father. Yes, I do. Hallelujah. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. Father, we just pray for one another this morning. Move mightily, Lord, and touch us, God, in this place. How many of you believe that grace is all you need? How many of you believe that God's got a grace for your need? Is this mic on? Thank you. I appreciate Ann. Ann knows what this is all about. Ann, give us your testimony.
I've never done this before, so I hope I can get through it. But for 7 years, I've been fighting a big battle. Big, big battle. I've been through a lot of trials, and God's always been there with me. At times, I fought depression very deep. And yes, depression is real. I was crushed. I put on a mask many, many times and walked in this church, and pastor would bring a message that I needed to hear, or the praise team would minister a song to me that I needed to hear. I would go home and I would get on my pity pot, and I would pray and I would ask God to help me. And I know without a doubt that God never took his hands off of me. And one day I just laid it before the Lord in the floor. I said, God, I can't take this anymore. I'm at the end. I know your mercy and grace is free and it's for me. And I know that I was highly favored by God and he was going to bring me through. But I didn't think it would take 7 years. And last week, I won my battle. And I just want to praise God, thank him for his mercy and grace. And like I said, I'm here today because of God.
Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. And Ann, you received a great healing a few months ago, too.
Yes, I went through melanoma. They cut it out of my back.
Sister Joyce, can you say praise God? She's been there. Amen. Let's give God praise. There's a grace for you. There's a grace for you. Amen. I've asked the praise team to lead us in our benediction. Don't go anywhere. We're going to sing His Grace Is Enough, just the chorus. Let's sing it as a benediction today before we go. Amen.
Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough.
Remember to meet us at 4 o'clock if you're helping. And if you've been given other instructions from that, like the nurses, you do what you've been instructed to do. The rest of us meet at 4 o'clock, meet in here, and we'll get ready, okay? God bless you. I love you.